Okay, so this session is formatted just a little bit differently. They're all a bit different to keep us on our toes. So we have 45 minutes in total, and we're going to have two 10-minute presentations, and we'll save all the questions for the end. The session title is Future Clinical Implementation, Roadblocks, and Opportunities. And our first speaker is one of our co-chairs of this meeting, Judy Cho. I introduced Judy at the beginning of the meeting yesterday, so I think we'll just jump in and give Judy her full 10 minutes for her talk.
Thanks, Erin. I'd like to just start by thanking the NHGRI team and my other members of the co-organizing committee. It's been a lot of fun seeing this go from an idea to actually happening. So what I'd like to cover in the next 10 minutes is the relationship between kind of genetics, multi-omics, and therapeutic targeting, and start by talking about the classic loss of function protective alleles, where one can make the argument that in the absence of multi-omics or really understanding the biology at all, you can go straight from genetics to successful therapeutic targeting. And if you think about that, obviously at the top of any list is going to be PCSK9, which has been mentioned a couple of times. And this work from Daniel MacArthur's laboratory, as well as obviously a large consortium effort, looking at the ratios of the predicted loss of function and the expected, you can see that this obviously is the kind of the classic example of where specific targeting results in a direct therapeutic agent. Using complementary approaches, King et al. Had published this a couple of years ago, where it's a systematic search of does genetics help you in direct therapeutic targeting? And the second half of this red underlined area is when the causal genes are clear, the success of human genetic evidence increases approval twofold. But of particular interest is looking at the first part of that kind of red underlined area, and that genes with genetically supported targets are more likely to be successful specifically in phases 2 and 3. And along those lines, one of the major therapeutic targets across autoimmunity is the interleukin 23R pathway. So coincident, happening at the same time as the GWAS when it first started getting active in 2006 and 2007, phase 2 studies of monoclonal antibodies that block both interleukin 12 and 23 were occurring. And really a striking what was evolved over the next few years, was very clear, is that if you look across these autoimmune diseases, those genes that have the associations to the interleukin 23R, and specifically, there are multiple independent alleles within IL-23R that are associated, but one of the more important ones is this arginine 3-in-1 glutamine. The major allele is arginine. The protective loss of function allele is glutamine. And so across autoimmunity, those diseases that actually show associations to IL-23R actually correspond quite well. There's a high correlation with blockade, with efficacy in terms of blocking the IL-23 pathway. And so that's the good news, but there's only a handful of examples where we clearly know the gene. It's of high enough effect sizes. And so because of that, for most of the genetic associations, it's less clear. You have a lot of biology that's involved. And there's one example of NOD2 and using NOD2 single cell transcriptomics and multi-omics in Crohn's disease. So inflammatory bowel disease affects not quite 1% of the American population. It has a peak age of onset of late childhood and early adulthood. And its clinical course is one of relapsing or remitting inflammation with progressive tissue damage. And for many, many years, until quite recently, the major agent that's used to treat moderate to severe Crohn's disease and less so ulcerative colitis is anti-TNF. And so in European ancestry Crohn's disease, the largest effects risk alleles are NOD2, just associated with Crohn's about 20 years ago. It's Crohn's specific, and it tends towards a particular complication of the disease of stricturing complications. And so for 20 years, we've been wondering how can loss of function alleles in a microbial sensing gene like NOD2 result in an increased risk for Crohn's disease? And we've made substantial impact on this, led by Shika Nayar in the laboratory, published a couple of months ago. And it was initially started by the observation in part A, again, looking at single cell analysis of inflamed versus uninflamed tissues, as well as peripheral blood mononuclear cells on the top of A. And our initial observation was, if you look at the second column, looking at NOD2 of the heat map, we can see the expression of NOD2 not just in the macrophages and the inflammatory macrophages, which a lot of the work of NOD2 in the intervening 20 years has focused on, but at the single cell level, we also saw expression of NOD2 in activated fibroblasts. And this kind of was, we were interested in studying then. This caused Shika to want to study the myeloid stromal niche, because the intestine is one of the unique tissues whereby the residential macrophages are continually replenished from blood monocytes. And so you can also see in the activated fibroblast data in the red rectangle, the key genes that kind of characterize this activated fibroblast signature, PDPN notably, MMP3, interleukin-11, CX13, as well as WT1. And so in part B, what Chica then did was sorted within the inflamed ileal tissue these double positive cells, as designated by the purple asterisk, CD14 positive, which are characteristic of blood monocytes, as well as PDGFRA, which is more characteristic of fibroblasts. And so within from biopsies, single cell suspensions, from inflamed versus uninflamed tissues, we can see that the activated fibroblast gene signature of IL-11, Chi3L1, PDPN, and WT1 is substantially higher in inflamed versus uninflamed tissues. Again, the WT1 gene is a particularly interesting transcription factor involved fundamentally in development, and transient gene expression we think plays a role in the pathogenesis of this disease. What Shika then did was work with Kyle Gettler in the lab of then taking differential gene expression between activated and non-activated fibroblasts, developing these gene lists, and then projecting them onto the pediatric inception cohort analyzed by, again, Subra Kugathasan and Greg Gibson, which is a bulk RNA-seq data set at the diagnostic endoscopy pretreatment. And you can see that there's correlation of both the activated fibroblast signature score as well as the inflammatory macrophage signature score that correlates with a number of NOD2 risk alleles in a dose-dependent manner. And this is the key in vitro study that Shika then performed, was that, again, given that blood monocytes then can then travel to the tissue and then result in altered differentiation, the chronic 2-week culturing of blood monocytes normally results in a mix of both fibroblasts as well as residential macrophages. But that what we show that is that NOD2 activation via myrable dipeptide, which is a minimal bioactive component of bacterial peptidoglycan, tends to bias towards macrophages. And so fundamentally, there's a defect of a failure to sense MDP or myrable dipeptide results in impaired and ultra differentiation and dysregulation of this myeloid stromal niche. And then in addition to this, what we then did was we took the single cell data of activated fibroblasts as well as inflammatory macrophages stratified on NOD2 genotypes and looked at the genes that were differentially expressed between NOD2 carriers and NOD2 non-carriers, and then performed pathway analysis to identify kind of what are the transcription factors that are regulating this gene expression. The biggest signals were included STAT3, WT1, but also NF-kappa-B. And so NF-kappa-B would be targeted by anti-TNF. And so we were particularly interested that a lot of this transcription factor analysis implicated the STAT3 pathway, affecting both arms of this dysregulated fibroblast myeloid niche. And so putting it all together, Shika then performed experiments with a small molecule inhibitor known as bazodoxifene, and this was part luck and part knowledge of the literature, is that we were looking at targeting a number of biologic pathways that have been implicated in anti-TNF non-response. In particular, Fiona Powery's work from Oxford had established that the OSM cytokine was particularly important and was elevated in those individuals that didn't respond to anti-TNF therapy. Now, OSM is part of this GP130 family. Other key cytokines that are involved in this include interleukin-11, which plays a key role in fibrosis pathways, interleukin-6, which plays a key role in growth and proliferation of the myeloid stromal niche, and that you can target all of them together by targeting GP130, which is bazodoxifene, which signals through that STAT3, and this activation pathway is then blocked by bazodoxifene. Putting this all together in terms of the genetics, we started with NOD2 and Crohn's disease 20 years ago, single cell RNA-seq implicates that NOD2 is expressed not just in macrophages, but also in fibroblasts. Bulk RNA-seq, we used both these inception pretreatment cohorts at the diagnostic colonoscopy, as well as this data set from Argus et al., where you're having sampling pre and post anti-TNF treatment to identify a new treatment target that is untargeted with present therapies. And so obviously making the connections between these things is how we're proposing this new therapeutic target. So Nancy Cox started this workshop by emphasizing the importance of repurposing across related traits. And this is a potentially a very highly effective means of both pleiotropy and unexpected pleiotropy. Because there's only a limited number of these high effect loss of function protective alleles, we need to move towards multi-omic integration. Rare cells are important. We've talked a lot about blood versus tissue. And again, as we try to think about therapies, which is where we want to go for genetics, 4A and B are obvious. We need to validate and we need to de-risk the next critical step in treatment development. I have a number of, we have great collaborators, both internally and externally. So I'd be happy to take any questions. Or actually, we'll go to the next talk.
Yes, Judy, thank you. That was really elegant data that you shared with us. So let's move on to our next speaker. Yes, as Judy said, please keep your questions at the ready. So I'd like to introduce Dr. David Craig. He's the professor of translational genomics and vice chair of the Department of Translational Genomics within the Keck School of Medicine at the University of Southern California. Dr. Craig's lab is focused on developing approaches for integrating and modeling data spanning from the individual nucleic acid molecules and cells to systems level clinical measurements with the ultimate goal of improving our ability to understand disease diagnosis, treatment, progression, and prevention. And Dr. Craig's talk is titled Perspectives and Lessons Learned from Moving Genomics into the Clinic. Take it away.
Thank you guys for inviting me. I'm really quite excited to be here, and I'll convince you of that in a few minutes. So I want to provide our perspective, or really a perspective, and I'm going to use kind of examples that are more that's science-based, more action-based. And so if we go ahead to the next slide. My research is really looking, like all of us, at integrative translational genomics and really kind of integrating across time and size. And we all see these different opportunities. And if we go to the next slide, it's important, I think, then where we kind of start. And for me, it starts really with a snapshot of what the NHGRI website looked like exactly 20 years ago today. And that's because when I started working, it was really with individuals, if you click, go ahead and click from that decided that leaving an environment and going to one where they had the ability to implement genomics within a clinic and maybe build their own CLIA lab was so important that they were willing to leave this home of genomics, NHGRI, and move to Arizona and to be really free and clear from that. And so in that sense, it was the biggest priority of translation to them. And they named the Institute that. And so from my perspective, that's where really I started. And so for the number one priority of the last 20 years was getting clinical tests. That was the number one thing. And so if we go to the next slide, we see kind of a 20-year transition for me. And we start in the upper left, we see large scale consortiums that we were involved with, activities. And these are really important. These are things that existed like Thousand Genomes that helped build a framework. We had the ability to build clinical labs, and that allowed us probably by about 2007, 8, 9 to be able to look at integrated analysis of RNA and DNA for prospective trials. The idea that rare diseases, we were really starting to see some impact. Nancy Cox pointed to the fact that we're only doing about 50% of the time for those. But when we started a few years before that, we were only figuring those out at a 5 to 10%. So I'm going to call that a tenfold increase in the rate of diagnosis. And in cancer, that's an area I feel that is a little bit neglected. If from a somatic side, we were seeing a big impact in terms of therapy treatments. And so these are things that really became powerful, and they kind of have led us to a transition where we really saw that we were reaching our limits. And so with all of these activities, what happened next is, I think what we see is the value of multi-omics, but what the action means is we decided, a lot of us did exactly what happened before, and we decided it was so important. We need to be within a medical system. And so we left TGen, which allowed us to build clinical labs with indirects, to land within USC, which had an integrated healthcare system, which allowed us to see the EHR. And the key message I have here is, if you said what I felt was important, I left the home state I lived in for 35 years, moved to LA, so did several of us. And in fact, TGen moved underneath a healthcare system, all to get access to the EHR, because what we realized was something else. It's not just about having a genome-wide span, it's to be able to have an expansive look at the EHR. We would see how information that a physician would have accessible really changed perspective, and it was context. So go ahead and go to the next slide, and the next few will be fairly quick. So this is my main thing, and I want to say what my kind of key messages are. EHR integration. I mean, you've got to look at the actions. All of us who believed that clinical lab tests, we're willing to walk away from that and to start over just to get within the EHR. And this is entire institutes built around that. So I think that's important. And it's really important to understand how we do that in a way that respects sovereignty and privacy. When we're talking about reaching populations that have sovereignty and are part of America, I mean, we've got to understand that they need to, we have to think about what privacy means to them, yet we still need to mandate some level of data sharing. Standards matter. I think the one thing I would point out is that NHGRI did not necessarily push in some of the somatic landscape. And I felt that they could have, and some of the impact that didn't happen is, you know, we don't have a great standard like NA12878. VCF and BAMs are kind of germline specific. I want to emphasize about how that's done. And sometimes it requires private-public partnerships. And I'll talk about that in a second. And then I want to also mention that multi-omics is impacting the clinic, and I'll highlight that as well. So go ahead and go to the next slide. And so open data standards impact, go ahead and just click. And if you just keep clicking through, this is where we had put together an effort to really build out and understand COLO 829 as our standard. And we had to do it kind of on our own. And it was partly because this is something that was not a priority for really anyone at NIH. And allowed us to look at reproducibility. Actually, in 2020, we discovered it wasn't always the perfect line. So you could reproducibility, we could show how we kept getting different clones the same way. Single cell opened up all sorts of insights. Go ahead and click to the next slide. Those were relevant for moving things into the clinic. One thing people talk about is a lack of actual data to train students. And I'm going to tell you, if you want to do one thing, it's to actually create disease-specific resources, like how 1000 Genomes is, where everybody can access it. It can be accessed in a class to learn how to study disease, how to identify genetic basis of disease from a genome. Find me a genome where we can do that. We all go to 1000 Genomes, healthy people, our tumor normal, cancer. We're not training students because you have to join a lab to see data. And then by that time, it's too late. Next slide. So I wanted to emphasize a few real important private-public partnerships. AMP-PD is something we're a part of, and we've released, there's a paper coming out, 10,000 participants, really rich phenotyping. I think about 9,000 whole blood RNA samples. Most of it are at four different time points, incredible data that goes about a billion reads overall, 200 million at month 0, 12, 4, and so forth. It's missed sometimes because it's not part of a traditional framework. It's part of the AMP-PD. If you want to see some really incredible data that's fully available for everyone, take a look at that. Go ahead and go to the next slide, because it really does tell us some things. Everybody keeps talking about needing aging data. So this is PAX change, five time points, and just walk through these. Go ahead and click. So these are some of the samples. There's a Sankey diagram showing the flow. We have whole genome sequencing. You can look at LDL and the healthy controls. This is really great resource. And I guess I'm right here just promoting it. And so if you go to amppd.org, you can learn about it. Go ahead and click. And right here, this is about some pictures from a paper coming out a few weeks in Nature Aging, where you actually show the progression. What we're seeing is enrichment of neutrophils over our study. So we have the same individual at four different time points. So we're doing exactly what people see. And what we see is really a significant change in the neutrophils. And that's where we're looking at whole blood again. And then we're thinking to ourselves, boy, single cell would have been nice. But still, this is a tremendous resource. And there's a paper coming out. Go ahead and do the next slide. So, we took the same 96 individuals, and we did a series of multi-omics and part of another consortium called Foundum PD. This is coming out soon too. Go ahead and click twice. And these are some of the individuals involved. And if you want to take a look at it, we have single cell RNA-seq from iPSCs, ATAC-seq, HiSeq, just about every omic. So it's the same individuals, but we generated iPSCs and neuronally differentiated them and made this as kind of a resource to see what parts of this are useful. So it's a great resource, foundumpd.org. Go ahead and click. And we're going to get the other aspect that we're trying to integrate in is spatial, and to understand spatial, that is something that we're finding new areas of. If you go ahead and click twice, we're finding there are new ways to think about this. One of the things we found is, you know, RNA helps us, but we were looking at the DNA information. We were finding spatially distinct, click once, regions that showed loss of heterozygosity. And that was probably because there was an EGR amplification taking off in one tiny corner that from the H&E, we could see some specific things happening that the pathologist was excited. Go ahead and click the next slide. And we started to ask these questions. This is just a slide to remind us that hence history does matter when we make clinical tests. First clinical test really did have a bias, false positive rate. Go ahead and click twice, where depending on your underlying population, your number of private mutations led to false positives. Go ahead and click next slide. And I just want to say that we're going to be impacting clinical management already. I know about clinical tests and I know the impact. And I also know that we filter away a lot. And what we filter is based on databases. The genome database started impacting things so early. And I'm already seeing, go ahead and click on the next few slides to take us to the end, how computational aspects of ACMG are starting to allow us to add in new filters to expand beyond coding exons to 3-4 bases within the exons to find cryptic splice site variation. And I can see how that filtering scheme will change. And this is an example where we find an intronic variant that a 20-year diagnostic odyssey gets solved. And so I'm really interested in this common variant aspect of the other 50%, but beyond the exome, that's important too. And so that pretty much brings me to the end, or you go ahead and click through where the clinical test kind of takes us. So these are my key messages that I want to end with. And I will go ahead and end. And by the way, I am at Disneyland right now. I found a corner of Disneyland, but apparently I can't project my slides. So thank you for being accommodating. I could actually unmask my background. That's what's great about these pandemics. And you guys can get a live shot of Disneyland.
Thank you so much, David, and thanks for joining our workshop while you're on vacation.
And that's awesome. How committed I am.
Wonderful. So that was a phenomenal talk as well, and I know it's so hard to pack in so much information into 10 minutes, but you both did a fantastic job. So we have 20 minutes for our discussion. Just a reminder that the session title, Future Clinical Implementation Roadblocks and Opportunities. And we've heard, you know, Nancy kicked us off with her talk in the beginning. You know, we looked at the portfolio analysis. We realized there's a significant and growing investment in omics research at the NIH, but there was the question of we haven't really seen the ability to move much of those biomarkers into the clinic. So we want to hear from all of you on what we need to do, research opportunities, other things that we need to make this happen. So either want to hear about that in general or specific questions for our speakers based on their presentations.
And I just wanted to emphasize that the comments Nancy made, the idea of federation is one that's really intriguing. The undiagnosed disease network kind of touched on that. That is a new area of data sharing. It's something to consider.
Thanks, David. Do we have any questions? Anyone want to weigh in? I mean, we certainly heard throughout the last day and a half comments about the need for the validation of these biomarkers. I think I'd have a question to put back at the group. Is there a role for NHGRI or the genomics community here to develop sort of standard validation pipelines, or is this really so specific to the particular disease being studied?
I think the one thing I would say that was most important, I was at Thousand Genomes and I sat in front of Daniel MacArthur, and he was talking with, I believe, Christo, and they were just talking about trying to create a database that became Genome. And what happened, the first implementations utilized public databases to do filtering. So before validation occurs, bioinformatic methods are utilizing multi-omic approaches. So, you know, when Genome came out, or the exact database, 1000 Genomes came out, it was part of the filtering process. So in other words, it doesn't actually have to be clinically validated to influence what the final result looks like, what variants show up. The minor allele frequencies from 1000 Genomes shaped every single clinical report going forward.
Thanks, so, David. Yeah, that's a good reminder. So we have, I think I saw Greg's hand up, Greg Gibson.
Yeah, thanks, Erin. I was just going to say that nobody's really talked about ACMG guidelines yet. And so in the context of multi-omic, for example, using RNA-seq to identify a splice site variant, what challenges have those who've been implementing multi-omics in the clinic come up with in terms of establishing pathogenicity, and do the guidelines need to be revised?
That's really difficult. So in that one case, we went a lot into it. So, you know, there's so many different ways to look at RNA-seq and to validate it. I mean, we built an assay that was a technical approach for actually putting everything in. But at the end of the day, we found it was easiest to, you know, use the evidence with the pathologist under certain guidelines. It would only get us to really a VUS on the front page. And then usually what would happen is that would be enough for the clinician then to debate the evidence. RNA is really a difficult clinical biomarker to implement. And I guess I felt that it's more important to start thinking about how to integrate EHR data, because I think we need to go further. We did it, we tried. Then you want to ask a different question. We did X inactivation. It's a tough one. Put 5 years into it.
Thanks, David. Nilanjan?
Yes. So, yeah, that was excellent sessions. You know, the whole day was amazing. One, like, a general comment is that, you know, especially from a, there was a lot of talk about risk prediction and how multi-omics data can improve risk prediction. And I think in that context, other than, you know, validation, I think we need to define what is clinical utility. And in particular, for example, for PRS, polygenic risk scores, NHGRI had a recent reporting standard paper, you know, with the committee, and where we kind of wrote down what is the clinical utility, how it should be reported. And I think we need to do similar things for other biomarkers as well. Just showing that it has some predictive value, and it doesn't mean that it is going to be clinically useful. So we have to, you know, come up with criteria for where in a particular disease, how do you show clinical utility? If you're, for example, thinking about, you know, that it will help you to risk stratification or developing who should get certain therapies. So that's something we need to invest more time.
I think that's really a big challenge. One of the things.
It looks like we've got some support in the chat from that as well. So I think, Nilanjan, that's a really good point, and that might be something that comes back up in the recommendations as well. I see a bunch of other hands. So let's, I think I saw Tuli, then Ali.
Yes, go ahead, hi. Yeah, I wanted to get back to a point that I think Judy mentioned a little bit, and Craig and others, of kind of talking about mechanisms, getting to disease mechanisms, where I think that NHGRI is doing a huge amount of super valuable work setting up things like IGVF and other studies, like really getting into how does the genome work, which I think is at the core of NHGRI's mission. And I think that thinking about multi-omics in more sort of like a cohort setting has actually a really important role here. I don't think that we actually know how do we stitch together information that comes from CRISPRing some cancer cell line and multi-omics and naturally occurring genetic variation that we observe in human cohorts. And both can be informative of mechanism, but sort of thinking about principal ways of how to put these things together is, I think, something where I think NHGRI could play an important role. I don't know if others have comment on this or any thoughts.
Thank you. Thank you, Tuli. That's a good point. So Ali and then Mike.
Yeah, just a couple of quick comments. You know, I want to emphasize the data access, you know, points that have been brought up a couple of times now, access to EHR data. I mean, I think that's supremely critical for, you know, validating some of these prediction models. And we have, for example, the top med data sets out there. They published a paper on harmonizing phenotypes, but they have yet to distribute the code and phenotypes as related to that. Gets a little frustrating over time, I think, is a big problem. The a comment on you know, Greg's on the RNA-seq, and maybe it relates to some of the N of one sort of conversations that were had as well. I think Tuli knows this well. There are some methods out there taking population data, like Pejman Mohammadi, who worked with Tuli, has developed one of the methods where you can take, you know, population data to define what the normal range is, say for expression of a gene or maybe some other biomarker that you're following in a N of one study, and sort of establish the reference range based on the population and look at whether or not it deviates from that reference range. And I think we had a lot of good comments also on personalized reference ranges as well. And then finally, on the PR standards for clinical utility, I think David Craig was about to say it's very challenging. I think for, you know, it's easy to put standards for risk stratification, kind of more statistical measures. But once you get into clinical utility, I think it becomes pretty indication specific. So coming up with a particular standard for clinical utility that works across the board, I think might be a bit of a challenge.
I have a question for other folks. When Nancy talked about federated access to EHR, I've always been impressed with what the Undiagnosed Disease Network. Now, I'm just wondering if it's just me and a few others who think that that's a potential interesting way. I also worry about when she talked about getting attacked by cyber attacks at the same time. Is there anyone else who feels that federated EHR databases, like how Undiagnosed Disease Network would allow querying at different sites for different variants, you know, expanding upon that's worthwhile?
Does anyone want to weigh in on that, Judy?
The feasibility standpoint, not sure exactly how that would work operationally. As a point of principle, though, with respect to the electronic health record, the patient is the owner of their data, right? And so within New York State and New York City, you know, you can basically sign off that, yes, go ahead and share my EHR with these folks. But that may not scale efficiently. So I'm having trouble understanding a federated system across health systems. Patient directed can definitely work, but again, that
well, so what what the Undiagnosed Disease Network did with Broad and others, they used an auth02 connection framework where they got the ability to query variants across different sites and to share certain information under that protocol. In, you know, I guess they kind of stumbled in that area, and that's where, yeah. So I'm concerned about the technical aspects being too prohibitive, but it's kind of, if we're going to talk about lofty goals, I mean, if we were in psychology, we would not be we would be very impressed with how genomics shares data. So if we talked about how do we share things, is it just easier to, like you say, get approval to download it and put it together somewhere else in a safe site?
David, thank you. Let's move on to Mike and then Nancy. And there's a really good conversation in the chat if you want to take a look at that, David. Go ahead,
Mike. I retract the use of the term own.
Thanks, Judy. All right, Mike, then Nancy.
Yeah, just stepping back a bit. Now, it's true I missed some of the talks because of other commitments, but it seems to me multi-omics is super powerful for discovery, for analyzing systems, you know, for virtually all diseases, right? And every ome contributes. And that's been true for everything we've done with it. It's the proteome, metabolome. You do learn some pretty important stuff and it can lead to actionable information. But I think one bottleneck is this has come up several times, getting into turning things into clinical tests. And I think a lot of valuable clinical tests these days are going to be multi-analyte tests. And, you know, clinically we're used to one-off tests, or maybe a few analytes. But the reality is, I think the tests of the future might be analyzing 100 things or several hundred things, all with absolute quantification so that you can tell the results from one to the next. Now, quantification is relative quantifications there, but absolute quantification is usually missing in most multi-omics assays. So we definitely need that. But I think that is a bottleneck. And I can tell you for everything we've done, we have a new marker for insulin resistance. We can replace a $6,000 test with, you know, basically 20 analytes. But that's a real pain in the ass to develop that. And I think everyone probably on this call has some sort of similar situation for their favorite disease situation, where, again, that they can go after the major one with maybe one or two analytes. But if you really want to get a more comprehensive picture of disease, and, you know, most diseases are really syndromes. They involve a series of different underlying defects that are all bundled together. Diabetes is a great case of that. And so I think having multiple analytes to be able to tear that apart. But if we can set up ways of being more efficient of that, I think we have accelerate clinical impact. And then, of course, you have to show utility once you build those assays.
Thank you, Mike. So, Nancy, I'll turn it over to you. And then if we have time, I want to come back and also talk about sort of our discussions we've woven in about generalizability and promoting equity as we're thinking about moving into the clinic. But go ahead, Nancy, with your question.
So I just say that I think it is possible to federate important kinds of queries across many healthcare centers now. It's just a matter of coming together and agreeing to create some very straightforward sort of variant by diagnosis kind of pre-specified tables that are lookups that allow, you know, a query to be fair, put out across a large network. Anybody that has the capability, I mean, this is a lookup, not even a calculation. It should, in many cases, would be pre-established as a lookup. And at least as a start, there are very simple ways to set up federated queries across large systems. And what David described is absolutely possible to do in many healthcare centers, even now. But as more and more genetics data come in, those will become more and more powerful queries. And that's why it's so valuable to think about trying to establish the right governance and get a lot of buy-in from as many places as possible to enable these things to start moving forward, because as the data come in, this becomes a richer and richer resource that accelerates things faster and faster in a good way for helping our patients and for helping us learn better than how to help our patients even more. And I absolutely agree with Mike. We have to move towards these multi-analyte, very straightforward to things that are very straightforward to validate, enable to be validated. But boy, I also think we've got to push more for things like RNA-seq that are so rich. Even though it's hard, there has to be a way to pull information from some of the rich omics that can be useful. And so that we have to push on both fronts, take the easy wins where we can and keep pushing on the harder omics because they are so rich.
On the RNA question, we can get to very straightforward, a kind of a technical RNA, where it's basically all of these measurements are made in a CLIA environment, and then not make an interpretive report. Is that a value? Because that is very doable.
Does anyone want to comment on that question?
That CLIA line is a big line. You're either CLIA or you're not. You can either return the results back or you can't. That's my experience. But other people may have different experiences. I mean, it's a big line to cross. That's just my experience.
So yeah, in our closing 3 minutes here, again, just coming back to our big question. So we're hearing a little bit about some of the steps that we need to, we heard a lot about the barriers, some steps that we need to take. I mean, we're hearing about needing the EHR integration. There's been such rich conversations about the data sharing. What about thinking about generalizability and health equity in 2 minutes remaining? We don't have much time, but does anyone have anything they want to put on the table here?
Need to do more.
There's a fundamental challenge where major medical centers tend to have a bias towards a very not representative kind of view of the United States. And I mean, you have to fight to get to the places that are more. Patients, you know, don't end up there. They end up with later stage cancer, different cancer, right? They end up at county hospital systems. And we've got to find ways to engage them on terms that they understand. A Native American population has sovereignty. Can they have some say over their data that's a little bit distinct? I think we have to be flexible sometimes in order to engage certain groups, and it's worth it.
Thank you,
David. It's absolutely worth it, but there's a real trust challenge. There is a trust challenge in recruiting, and we have to really address that through workforce, through many things.
Thanks, Judy. I'm going to give Thule the last question or comment.
I just wanted to comment on what was said and elaborate a little bit on the do more aspect. So now that there's a lot of investment in making GWAS data sets more diverse, and this is moving, we have to make the functional interpretation of references more diverse as well. There is no GTEx resource that actually covers diverse ancestries. And as long as we don't have those, we may end up in a situation where it's like, okay, so now you did the GWAS this, but we're super far behind when it comes to functional interpretation. So yeah, those gaps just need to be filled.
That is a great and important point to close on. So I think we're gonna wrap up this session now. There's just such an amazing conversation happening on many levels in the chat. So we're glad we'll be able to capture all of that. And we will turn over the remainder of the time to Howard and Judy for recommendations.